In 1996, Scottish scientists shocked the world with the announcement that they had successfully created a clone from a living sheep. Since then, scientists have cloned cattle, cats, deer, horses, mules, oxen, rabbits, rats, and just 2 years ago, monkeys. Meaning that the possibility of cloning human beings can't be that far off. Which may seem exciting for researchers who could use the process to eradicate diseases and improve human life, but it would be an ethically regrettable choice that could really tear humanity apart worse than it already is. Why are some working to make this a reality, and what ethical problems does the Catholic Church have with it? This is Catholicism in Focus. To start off, it might be helpful to give a quick overview of what the scientific process of cloning actually entails so that we're all on the same page. Because, as is commonly thought, cloning is not simply a matter of making a carbon copy of yourself that looks and acts exactly like you. The reality is that a clone can be quite different from the original. The way it works is this. Researchers take a somatic cell from the being they want to clone, basically a cell from an already living creature other than its reproductive cells, and extract its nucleus, containing the cell's DNA. The nucleus is then placed inside of an egg cell that has had its nucleus removed and is given an electrical charge to begin growing. If the goal is reproduction, the cell can be placed within a female host and brought to term, or remain in a test tube for research purposes, but since it already contains the complete DNA of an animal, it has no need for fertilization. Rather, it is already a living organism able to develop, from itself alone, into an embryo. If brought to term, the clone will be very similar to its donor, as it shares in the same DNA, but it won't be identical. The fetal environment of an embryo has a major effect on determining which genes are ultimately activated, not to mention that the surrogate egg cell retains some DNA material. Beyond this, a person is more than just nature, but also the result of nurture, and so the environment one is raised in would produce entirely different experiences, and thus personality. Meaning that cloning will not bring someone back from the dead or make an exactly new version of someone we've lost. Cloning is about DNA, not consciousness or personhood. That said, proponents of cloning are not small in number, recognizing many benefits they could have for humanity. From a scientific standpoint, cloning presents an opportunity to research genetic material, test the effect of new therapeutic techniques, manipulate genes to remove defects, and conduct experiments that could lead to medical breakthroughs. More directly beneficial to human beings, organs and cell tissue could be artificially produced to save lives, reduce discomfort, and prevent medical emergencies, all without the need for living donors, not to mention the obvious desire to recreate lost loved ones or to genetically fashion healthy offspring at will. These are not small benefits for sure, and so you can see why people would push for it. That said, you can also see why Catholics would be vehemently against it as immoral. For starters, the act of cloning disconnects procreation from the sexual act. Like in vitro fertilization, life is brought about not because of two people engaging in an act of love, but rather because of a scientific process carried out in a sterilized laboratory. The Catechism of the Catholic Church, quoting the CDF's Donum Vitae, teaches, "The act which brings the child into existence is no longer an act by which two persons give themselves to one another, but one that entrusts the life and identity of the embryo into the power of doctors and biologists, and establishes the domination of technology over the origin and destiny of the human person. Such a relationship of domination is in itself contrary to the dignity and equality that must be common to parents and children." If this is a problem even when the process is sought by married people seeking help with their infertility, how is it even conceivable to do this when there isn't even a mother or father to speak of? Just the creation of a human being based on the copying of genetic material. In the cloning process, the basic relationships of the human person are perverted. Filiation, consanguinity, kinship, parenthood. In vitro fertilization has already led to the confusion of parentage, but cloning will mean the radical rupture of these bonds. Think about what it's like to grow up in a broken home without parents around. Now think about a life in which you literally don't have parents, in which your life is defined by being a copy of someone else. Not great. It's because of this that the Church writes, "This practice paves the way to the clone's radical suffering, for his psychic identity is jeopardized by the real, or even by the merely virtual, presence of his other." Of course, this all assumes that the clone is viable and is actually intended to be brought to term. While reproductive cloning is part of the issue, it is by no means the only or most unethical issue at play here. For many, the real goal is therapeutic cloning, the creation of duplicate human embryo for the purpose of testing and ultimate destruction. When people talk about cloning offering an answer to diseases and limiting the need for living organ donors, they're not talking about creating an isolated liver or a few cells here and there. They're talking about creating a living human embryo in a laboratory so that they can harvest its cells, organs, and unique tissue before throwing it away. This is not the plot of a dystopian sci-fi movie. This is what a lot of normal people are advocating as a brilliant opportunity in the future. On one website, an organization tried to assuage skeptics worried about a future of clone slaves harvested for organs by saying, "No, don't worry, that's what therapeutic cloning is for," as if an embryo isn't just as alive and human. In 2003, Archbishop Celestino Migliore, permanent observer of the Holy See to the United Nations, spoke at the International Convention Against the Cloning of Human Beings, saying, "Human rights flow from the recognition that human beings have an intrinsic dignity that is based on the fact that they are human. Human embryos are human even if they are cloned. If the rest of us are to have the rights that flow from the recognition of this dignity, then we must act to ban cloning in all its forms." Cloning is simply not good or ethical for the clone. Either it's meant for reproduction and lives a dehumanized life without parents and as a second-class citizen, or it's created for the mere purpose of being gutted. But it's not just the clone that suffers. As the Church reflected in 1997, women are radically exploited and reduced to a few of their purely biological functions, providing ova and womb. They too are harvested for their eggs and have their bodies used to carry artificially created embryos to term, reducing their dignity to mere utility. But it doesn't stop there either. All of us, as a human family, suffer because of cloning. In human cloning, the necessary condition for any society begins to collapse. That of treating man always and everywhere as an end, as a value, and never as a mere means or simple object. When procreation, the most sacred act that we can take part in, is reduced to scientific mastery, and life itself is not seen as a gift from God, but merely an object to be exploited for our own gain, then what happens to humanity itself? From where do we derive our rights and dignity and worth? How can we say that our life is important if we treat other life with such disregard? Cloning is bad news for everyone, and we must resist it. Unfortunately, when we look at the state of the world, the idea of entirely preventing it from happening seems an impossibility. While claims for a successful human clone have turned out to be false thus far, it is only a matter of time, which raises an interesting question. What happens when it does? What do we make of this human being, created through a wildly unethical process? Frankly, nothing. While the process itself is abhorrent and a mockery to God, an attempt to replace God by artificially creating life, the fact of the matter is that no one can really play God. At the end of the day, we might be able to manipulate genes, to copy DNA material and produce life without parents, but we can't take something that isn't alive and give it life. No matter how a person is created, whether by the conjugal act, by in vitro fertilization, even by cloning, the result is no less amazing than anything else. This is a human being, complete with body and soul, imprinted with life and dignity from God. No test tube can do that. No scientific mastery can make that happen. Playing God may reduce us before God, but it can't take away from the magnificent mystery of life.